So this segment on cell membrane transport is going to be covering facilitated diffusion. And so if you recall, facilitated diffusion is a form of passive transport. So again, be sure to go back and review the properties of passive transport that were discussed in an earlier video. We'll have additional videos coming up on osmosis, primary transport, and secondary active transport. So with facilitated diffusion, now what we're doing is since again this is a passive movement, and so we know that the solute that's going to diffuse is going to be moving down its gradient. Okay, so along the gradient and down the gradient mean the same thing. It's facilitated, however. So if you facilitate something, what does that mean? Okay, to facilitate means you help it. And so in facilitated diffusion, we can help a solute move, or the membrane can help a solute diffuse, by using a transmembrane protein. There are a couple of different types of transmembrane proteins that are used in facilitated diffusion. Those transmembrane proteins include carriers and channels. So both types of transmembrane proteins can be used in facilitated diffusion. And so let's talk about what types of solutes would use facilitated diffusion. So once again, you're going to need to think about the chemical makeup or the chemical composition of the phospholipid bilayer. So again, you've got your fatty acid tails that are lipid soluble. And we talked in a previous video about solutes that freely diffuse, meaning they have a high permeability, because they're lipid soluble or they're lipophilic. Solutes that have to use facilitated diffusion, however, are not lipid soluble. So they are lipid insoluble. And if you have a solute that's lipid insoluble, that is telling us that it is lipophobic. It doesn't want to mingle, right? It has a fear of fat, so it's not going to mingle with your lipid, okay? So, or with the phospholipid bilayer. So not only is this solute lipophobic, it's hydrophilic. So it loves water. And so if it's hydrophilic and it loves water, that means then that your solute must have a charge affiliated with it. Remember, water, whenever you're making a solution and you put water into a solution, if you recall, a water molecule has partial charges. And so if your solute has a charge, those charges can be attracted to the charges on this water molecule. Hence, there's an attraction. That solute is hydrophilic. It loves water. It's going to interact with it. Okay, so then the solutes then that are going to be using a transmembrane protein then are going to be hydrophilic and lipophobic. They're going to be large and polar, because remember, polar means that the solute has charges. So these are large and polar. All right, so large solutes that also have a charge can use transmembrane protein. All right, now with transmembrane proteins, these are going to be illustrating the concept of specificity. So carriers and channels illustrate this concept, and you'll see that here shortly. Okay, so let's look at an example of facilitated diffusion. So here we're looking at the extracellular fluid. Down below is the intracellular fluid, and in between is the plasma membrane, the phospholipid bilayer. And within that phospholipid bilayer is your carrier molecule, your transmembrane protein. So if you notice in step one here, we have a high concentration of our solute, which is shown in green, in the extracellular fluid. And we have a low concentration of solute in the intracellular fluid. So we know if you have a high concentration, these molecules in the extracellular fluid start colliding and bouncing off one another, we're going to generate a lot of energy. And therefore, more collisions and more energy. So we're going to drive this molecule across that membrane. However, it's too large to freely diffuse. Or perhaps it's polar. Okay, so it could be large and polar. And so it needs a carrier protein. So Here comes your solute. It has to come into the carrier protein and it must bind. So solutes bind to carrier proteins. And notice the shape. The site where the solute binds, okay, that site fits perfectly with the shape of your solute. So that means that our carrier molecule illustrates the concept of specificity. So what that means is only certain carrier proteins or carrier molecules can transport certain solutes. For example, you would have a glucose transporter that transports glucose. It's a very specific carrier molecule that only transports glucose. Okay, so once this solute binds to the carrier protein, let's look at what happens in step two. So in step two, then, you'll notice that there's a conformational change in the carrier. So carrier molecules not only illustrate specificity, but they also undergo a conformational change. Then in step three, that solute can then be released to the intracellular fluid once that conformational change has occurred. And then lastly, in step four, that carrier protein will revert back to its original conformation so that it can transport more of that solute into the cell. So this is an example where we're bringing a solute into the cell. You can also provide an example where you have a carrier protein transporting a solute out of the cell. So either way, carrier proteins are going to assist large and polar, hydrophilic, or lipophobic solutes. Okay, and again, carrier proteins illustrate the concept of specificity and undergo a conformational change. All right, so here's a little question for you. So pause the video briefly and then figure out in which direction will this solute diffuse. So the solute that you're working with is lipid insoluble and you have a transmembrane protein present. That could be either a carrier or it could be a channel. So the direction of diffusion. So in order to determine which direction the solute will move, you want to find out, first off, you already know it's facilitated diffusion, so you know your solute's going to be moving along a gradient. So if there's a higher concentration of solute in the extracellular fluid, you're going to generate more collisions, therefore generate more energy to drive that solute in to the cell. So then there's a question for you. Will this direction of movement continue until all of the solute has diffused? And the answer is no. Okay, once that solute reaches equilibrium, meaning you have the same concentration inside as you do outside, then diffusion will stop. Okay, so now you also have diffusion through channels. And remember that channels are a type of transmembrane protein. So this is also considered facilitated diffusion. And so when we look at this diagram, here we have a channel. A channel is much like a drinking straw, right? So a solute does not bind to a channel. If you're drinking iced tea, for example, or you're drinking a peanut butter chocolate milkshake, all right, that doesn't bind to the straw, okay? That solute freely passes, okay, or just passes through the straw, okay? Shouldn't use the term freely because you might think it freely diffuses and that would be incorrect, because you're using a transmembrane protein, okay? So whatever solute it is passes through the straw or passes through the channel. Now, these channels do exhibit specificity. So for example, you may have a sodium channel. So only sodium will pass through that channel. Or maybe you have a potassium channel and only potassium passes through that channel. So channels exhibit specificity much like carrier proteins do. Okay, now, does the channel undergo a conformational change when solutes pass through? And the answer to that is no. There's no conformational change in a drinking straw, okay? It retains its shape. It doesn't change at all. Now, there are different types of channels. And so, you have some channels that are always open. So, if they're always open, these are called leak channels. And we'll be talking a lot about leak channels throughout this semester. We also have gated channels, and there's a lot of different types of gated channels. So We'll get into the subcategories of gated channels at a later time. Okay, so this concludes the video on facilitated diffusion.